There are two major categories of herb-drug interactions, and the first one is what we call a pharmacodynamic interaction. And that's just a situation where the botanical has a pharmacological property either very similar to a conventional medication or just the opposite of a conventional medication. And so I just want to look at three examples here. The ephedra supplements, which are no longer on the market, the ephedra-free products, which have taken their place, and then licorice, and I'll just throw that one in the mix because it's found in a lot of ephedra-free supplements. Now, of course, I like to use the ephedra-containing dietary supplements to illustrate the concept of pharmacodynamic herb-drug interactions simply because we were involved in what I like to call the Ephedra Wars. And so from 1995 until 2005, the medical literature was awash with case reports describing cases of heart attacks, strokes, seizures, and psychoses that were linked to the use of ephedra-containing dietary supplements. And three of the more popular culprits were Rip Fuel, Metabolife, and Xenadrine RFA. And we managed to endear ourselves to all those companies during back in the day. Anyway, and we can talk about ephedra war stories a little bit later. But nonetheless, so for all, you're all probably familiar with ephedra. It's a natural source of the ephedra alkaloids or the ephedrine alkaloids, which are sympathomimetic agents. So things like ephedrine, pseudoephedrine, methylephedrine, norephedrine, sometimes known as phenylpropanolamine, and then norpseudoephedrine, which is actually a controlled force stimulant, schedule four stimulant. Now, of course, like most botanicals, the content of ephedrine alkaloids could vary considerably depending upon which species was actually used, the location of where it was grown, the growing conditions, when it was harvested, how it was processed, so on and so forth. So a lot of those conditions could affect the ephedrine alkaloid content from not only from brand to brand, but sometimes even from lot to lot. And one of the main problems with ephedra supplements is that they were almost always formulated with a wide variety of other botanicals, many of which were also natural stimulants like the ephedrine alkaloids. Now, during the ephedra wars, the manufacturers would always tout the safe track record that ephedra had in China. And so, unfortunately, the Chinese used ephedra quite differently than how it was used in the United States. And so, the Chinese, for the most part, clearly had been using it for several thousand years, but they almost always used it to treat asthma or nasal congestion. They rarely recommended that it be used for more than 7 to 10 days, and they rarely combined it with other stimulants like caffeine. It was almost always administered as a decoction or a tea where you would sip it, and then it was never indicated as a diet aid. Well, contrast that to how it was used here in the States from instead of 5,000 years, just 10 years, but it was almost always marketed as a diet aid or an energy booster or an exercise performance enhancer, and it was almost always indicated for chronic use. And they were almost always combined with other stimulants, primarily natural sources of caffeine, and they were administered as concentrated extracts in the forms of tablets, capsules, and concentrated liquids. And so the Chinese learned a heck of a lot about ephedra in those 5,000 years. We just failed to heed any of that advice. Right. Now, one of the primary reasons for a lot of the problems associated with ephedra was the combination of ephedrine alkaloids and caffeine. And so most of the natural sources of caffeine that were utilized in conjunction with ephedra were guarana, green tea, kola nut, and yerba mate. And as a pharmacist, when these things first came out, it reminded me back in the day when the late 70s and the early 80s when I was in pharmacy school, when what was called the amphetamine lookalikes hit the market. And the amphetamine lookalikes are basically combinations of ephedrine, caffeine, and phenylpropanolamine. And not too surprisingly, you had a lot of case reports that linked the use of amphetamine lookalikes to heart attacks, strokes, seizures, and psychoses, to the point that the FDA said to the manufacturers, if you can't prove that these products are safe, you can't market them. And they didn't, because they couldn't prove that they were safe. And ultimately, they were taken off the market. It was first started in 83, and by 88, they were essentially off the market. And because the natural combinations of ephedrine alkaloids and caffeine fell under the definition of a dietary supplement when Deshaies came out, then you started to see these, for all intents and purposes, natural amphetamine lookalikes that were on the market at that point. Now, clearly, ephedrine and caffeine are both stimulants, and they can actually potentiate each other's cardiovascular and central nervous system stimulant effects. And if you go through the literature, it's anywhere between 1/5 and 1/10 the potency of amphetamine, which is a pretty potent stimulant. And one of the reasons for that is that in these formulations, you have to realize that there are other phytochemicals that are present in the ephedra-containing dietary supplement formulations, a lot of which, like the catechins and xanthones and tannins, can actually potentiate the sympathomimetic activity of ephedrine and caffeine because they can inhibit catecholamethyltransferase and certain monoamine oxidase inhibitors. And what's really interesting is that ephedrine and caffeine is one of the few drug combinations that can actually lower cerebral blood flow. And so that also may be one of the reasons why there was a number of ischemic strokes associated with the use of these products. Now, what I want to do next is just kind of illustrate how the complexity of an ephedra supplement formulation can enhance its toxicity. And so what I want to use here are four different formulations or products that we analyzed several years ago. The first one, EPH 833, just has ephedra extract. Then the others, Metabolife, Rip Fuel, and Xenodrine, these are just the other components that were in those formulations. So you can see that there's quite a bit of complexity. All of them contain guarana as a natural source of caffeine, and then some of them contain other sources of caffeine and other sources of natural stimulants as well. So kind of keep those in mind as we go through that, because remember, EPH 833 only has ephedra, nothing else. All right, so what I want to show you here is just this table represents part of a toxicity pilot study that we did, oh goodness, way back in the 90s, looking at the effects of ephedra supplements on mice. And this particular phase of the study, we had four mice in each group, and they received just 400 microliters of an aqueous extract of a single capsule of each one of these products. And so what you can see here is the mortality rate versus the dose. And you can see here with EPH 833, it has the highest ephedrine alkaloid dose, but no mortality, whereas the others have much lower ephedrine alkaloid doses, but significantly more mortality. And so again, in our opinion, it dealt more with the complexity of those formulations and the ability of these other phytochemicals to potentiate the toxicity of ephedrine alkaloids. So it wasn't just the ephedrine alkaloids in the cases here. All right. Now, one of the reasons for that, it just deals with the pharmacokinetics of ephedrine and caffeine. Ephedrine and caffeine are two of the rare phytochemicals that have very good oral bioavailability, almost 100%. And they're also absorbed very quickly. And so here's looking at the concentration time profiles for, this is ephedrine and caffeine. You can see that the time that it takes to reach peak concentrations are almost identical. And so you've got two stimulants getting into the systemic circulation pretty quickly at about the same time. All right? And so, but what was really problematic with most of the ephedra-containing dietary supplements is that they were almost always marketed to be taken in conjunction with vigorous exercise. And all that does is just exacerbate the sympathomimetic effects of ephedrine and caffeine. I like to call it a sympathomimetic storm when you take these things and do vigorous exercise. And if you actually go through and look at all the adverse event reports and case reports that appear in the medical literature, exercise is a fairly common component of all of those. But they were literally marketed to be taken just prior to engaging in vigorous exercise. And so, of course, you're all probably familiar that there were several highly publicized deaths of some professional and collegiate athletes back in the late 90s and early 2000s. And then once the media got into the frenzy, and then the sales of ephedra supplements just started to plummet.